flagship whiskey right here. If Brumbani didn't have a standard whiskey, this would be it. But what you have to remember is we just recently reopened. So in 2001, a group of investors, actually a wine merchant from London, we never hold that against them, came up to Ireland, decided they wanted to buy Brumbani, wanted to buy the distillery. And what he did is he went to the owners at the time, and the owners came back to him and said, you can have it. It's going to cost you £2.5 million for the distillery. It's going to cost you £5 million for all the whiskey that's sitting in the warehouse. We paid twice as much for the old stock as we did for the plant itself. That gives you an idea of what these guys are sitting on. Stuff that went right back to 1961. That puts in a really nice position. We inherited this museum, this old Victorian powerhouse of a distillery. And we had all the stock to play with while our old whiskey was maturing. So one of the next whiskey try after this one is from the old stock. It'll give you a wee bit of an idea of how the spirits changed slightly. Over the last 10 years though, we've had a bit of a challenge because we never release whiskey before it's ready. We did release a good deal of our whiskey at 7 years old, but I think we'll agree after tasting that organic, it's pretty delicious at 7 years old. But in that first 7 years, what we decided to do is we poached our master distiller from a distillery across the bay, from Beaumont. This guy, as a 15-year-old, started coopering barrels on Ireland. And he worked for 40 years at Beaumont, learning every part of the trade. He knows oak inside out, he has done since he was a child, because he was a cooper before he was allowed to drink. He worked as well as the distillery manager and master blender, and then we went across to see him and said, how much would it cost us to get you to come from Beaumont to work for us at Brumbani? And he turned around and he said, you guys are here with Brumbani? We said, yes. He said, is it still all the old equipment? We said, yes. He said, I cannot wait to get my hands on that equipment. He came across the bay, he's never been back since. And what we said to him was, here's £5 million worth of spirit in all these different casks. Do what you like with it. He was in whiskey heaven. We just said to the most experienced whiskey maker in Scotland, here you go, no old part. And he went away and he started to do various finishes. He started to make sure that our brew policy was the best it possibly could be. But most importantly, he was the guy that in 2001 started laying down spirit that would eventually go in to the 10-year-old. So up until now, the only thing consistent about Brumbani has been our wonderful inconsistency. We've tried everything. And now we're at a stage where our whiskey's coming of age, where we can start to say, well, that worked and that didn't. So we are starting to narrow down our range. We're going from 31 standard products to around about 15. So we still have a wonderful variation for all you guys to try. But by far the biggest challenge for us was to stick around for at least a decade. And what you have in your glass right now is the first 10-year-old where every single drop in there is made by the current guys at the distillery. This is what they've been working towards. This is what they wanted. And Jim McEwen has basically blended 90% bourbon casks with 10% sherry casks to give you what he thinks is the ultimate Islay whiskey. Perfect balance between cask and between distillery. Have a sniff, have a taste. Let me know what you think of this particular one. Okay, one thing that's quite interesting about this is it has a little bit of smoke at the end. The 2003 didn't. We generally use no peat whatsoever in our standard Brumbanis. However, in 2001, when we first opened, we decided that we would need to start buying barley from the local maltsters because we had enough to basically deal with back then. We didn't want to have to think about sourcing barley. So we went to Port Ellen Maltings on Islay. And we said to these guys, can you sell us some barley? And he said, yeah, no problem. We said, can you make it unbeaten? And they said, unfortunately not. You know, they malt barley from the rest of the island. It's such an industrial process there that they don't have the ability to do small batches of unbeaten. So they said to us, we can't make what you want, but we can give you what you want. We can give you the volume that you want. So we said, great. We bought a few batches from them. But then we went back to them and said, can we get more of that? And the truck driver said, okay, we can, but we want you to pay 6 months in advance, and we can't guarantee to give you everything you've paid for. Basically, you guys are coming in here, you're challenging all these conventions, we think that barley doesn't make a difference, get off the island, was the message that we got. And it was a blessing in disguise. We were looking for another maltster, and we found maltings up in Inverness in the northeast of Scotland. And the beauty of these guys is they do everything on a small scale. Every batch of barley that we send up to them is malted on a single field, and if you can't do that, single farm basis. Ultimate traceability throughout the whole process. But because the first few batches came from Port Ellen, we did have a little bit of smokiness in the early 10-year-olds, and that's what's coming through in that one there. How's that tasting for you compared to the
audience?